Hello guys, what's up? Today, I want to take you through something that I've actually been meaning to revisit for a while. If you've been following my channel, you may remember I made a video some time ago about Intel 200S Boost. In that video, I was testing it with a DDR5 8000 MTS RAM kit, which is the max supported speed for 200S Boost. But it gave me a bit of trouble to set up properly, because that RAM kit is technically running out of spec for 200S Boost. It was running at 1.45 volts, while Intel requires the memory to be at 1.4 volts or lower in order for 200S Boost to be activated. While I was able to manually tweak them down to 1.4 in the BIOS, and then 200S Boost actually could be enabled on them. And the system will boot, it will pass all tests, and is stable as before. But in the back of my mind, I kept wondering, is this really stable long term, or even practical if I want to keep doing more 200S Boost comparisons, especially now that Gigabyte has rolled out new enhanced 200S Boost modes that I am planning to check out soon. That's why I finally decided to move on from that kit and use one that works out of the box without voltage tuning. So I got a DDR5 CUDIMM kit rated at 8400 MTS using XMP. I know that going from 8000 to 8400 MTS isn't some massive jump. It's not like it's going to blow my benchmarks wide open. But in reality, 200S Boost max out at 8000 anyway. So for me, the real reason behind this switch wasn't about chasing higher memory frequencies. It was about finally using something that works well with the platform at still high speed. And here is why CUDIMM matters. Unlike UDIMM, CUDIMM can push higher speeds while keeping the voltage lower. So the one I got runs at 8400 at exactly 1.4 volt, right in Intel safe zone for 200S Boost. Now let's talk about the other differences between these two kits. The UDIMM ones I had are two of 16GB sticks, so total capacity is 32GB. While the CUDIMM ones I got now comes in 24x2, so total capacity of 48GB. And both of them are single-sided models, which is a plus because single-sided memory tends to be more stable when you are pushing higher frequencies and have lower latency. And both of them use Hynix dies, which are excellent for high-speed memory. But the older UDIMM kit runs at CL38, while the new CUDIMM kit is rated at CL40. And if you dig a little deeper into the timings, things like TRP, TRAS, and the secondary values, you will notice the UDIMM kit I have is generally tighter across the board. That makes sense. The higher the frequency, the looser the timings usually have to be to keep things stable. But here is the million-dollar question. Do those more relaxed timings actually cost me a real-world performance? That's exactly what I want to find out. And in this video, we're going to look at the benchmarks to get that answer. Alright, with that said, let's get over the setup for these benchmarks we are about to do. For both memory kits, I run them on their top XMP profiles with Intel 200S Boost disabled. The CPU is Intel Core Ultra 265K. Paired with the Aorus Elite X-Ice motherboard. A pretty solid mid-range board, I would say. For the GPU, I have the Radeon 7800 XT. I know it's not the most high-end for 4K, but for 1080p and 1440p, it should get the job done, I guess. Alright, now let's get into the benchmarks. Starting with IDA 64 memory benchmark, we have tests for read, write, copy, and latency. This one always interesting, and here is what I found. The biggest difference was in memory read speed. The CUDIMM actually pulled ahead by about 4GB, which is not earth-shattering, but it's there. For write, copy, and latency speeds, both kits were basically identical. So overall, the biggest difference was in read in IDA 64 synthetic benchmark. Next up, 3D Mark. In TimeSpy, they scored right around 21,000. Practically identical. Now I also ran Steel Nomad, and it was the same story, no meaningful difference here, which honestly I kind of expected. But the real story, as always, is in gaming. I tested 6 different games across 3 resolutions, 1080p, 1440p, and 4K, all running on low settings, because the goal was to push CPU and memory scaling, not GPU power. First up, we have Cyberpunk 2077, and here's the CUDIMM 8400 edged out a small win, about 4fps higher at 1080p on average, 2fps at 1440p, and roughly 1fps at 4K. Not a huge deal, but at least it's there. Next, DDR5. This one was almost boring. Performance was basically identical across the board. Again, the same case in Age of Mythology Retold. No big winner here. Now here is where it got more fun. Rainbow Six Siege. This title is sensitive to memory timings, and it really showed here. The UDIMM kit at 8000 with lower memory timings actually beat the CUDIMM 8400 with higher memory timings. As you can see, at 1440p, the UDIMM setup hit 323 FPS compared to 316 with the CUDIMM. Even at 4K, the UDIMM kit still held the lead, and that's likely down to those tighter timings. Siege really benefits from lower latency memory, and it proves that frequency alone doesn't always tell the full story. But then, we switch over now to Far Cry 6, and the table totally turned around. At 1080p, CUDIMM 8400 gave me a nice 10fps boost. At 1440p, the difference was about 3fps on average, and at 4K, around 5. Not massive, but definitely noticeable, especially at lower resolutions where CPU and memory matter most. Finally, we've got Counter-Strike 2. At 1080p, the CUDIMM 8400 was ahead by around 30fps. Sure, 30fps sounds a lot, but we are talking about numbers already way up there. 649fps versus 679fps is only about 4.6% difference. At this already high FPS, you are not really going to feel the difference in game. But from a data perspective, it shows that in certain engines, memory bandwidth scaling can still make a clear difference. At 1440p and 4K though, things evened out. So what's the takeaway here? Honestly, if you already own 8000 UDIMM kit, you are already getting the most out of Intel high bandwidth capabilities. The performance difference in most games are really small, barely noticeable in day-to-day use. But the real win for me upgrading to a CUDIMM kit wasn't about squeezing out a few extra FPS. It's about maximum compatibility with 200S boost. I can finally activate it without having to tune voltages down. Plus, this CUDIMM kit gives me a 48GB instead of 32. And I paid basically the same price. From a value standpoint, that's pretty solid. Now, however, I do wish the timings were a bit tighter. I might actually try tightening them manually. Hynix dies usually have some headroom, so there is a decent chance I can shift down the latency without giving up stability. So if you are curious to see how far I can push this kit, make sure you are subscribed to the channel, as I might do a dedicated video for that. So at the end, if you ask me, should you go with CUDIMM? Honestly, it depends on your use. If you have already got a stable UDIMM kit and you are able to run 200S boost without issues, there is no urgent reason to change. But if you are thinking ahead, want to run high frequency at lower voltage, and want a bit more future-proofing, then CUDIMM kits are starting to look like a very attractive option, especially at some cost about the same as UDIMM now. I would really like to know, what do you guys think about the benchmark results between these two kits I've tested? Did you expect it to go this way? So drop your thoughts down in the comments. Thanks a ton for watching. And if you found this video helpful or interesting, don't forget to hit that like button and subscribe to the channel. I've got more 200S boost experiments on the way, including comparison with my recent manual undervolting tuning that you can see here in the recommended video, as well as testing out the new 200S enhanced modes that Gigabyte introduced in latest BIOS version. So stay tuned for that, and I'll see you in the next one.